Hello, hello, hello. Today is Monday, December 2, 2024. Here follow Kiese's solutions to problem 217. He writes, Walter Lewin discusses this problem in modules 01.03 and 02.02 of his weekly 1997 802 help sessions. He was then 61 years old. Notice there is a playlist called 802X MIT Help Sessions. You may look at those. There are many problems there that will help you. Now he continues. Almost all of you have parts B, C and D wrong. Only three people have all answers correct. A hollow spherical conductor carrying a net charge plus Q has an inner radius R1 and outer radius R2, which is 2R1. At the center of the sphere is a point charge plus Q over 2. See the figure. This is about the application of Gauss's law. Since this is an electrostatic problem, the electric field in any conducting region must be zero. We have spherical symmetry, so the only sensible closed surface for Gauss is a spherical shell. Thus any electric field at a radius R must be in a radial direction and have the same magnitude at any point on the shell. And here is his answer to question A. For R smaller than R1, the enclosed charge is plus Q over 2. And so Gauss' law immediately gives you then the E field. For R smaller than R2 and larger than R1, electric field is zero because it is a conducting part of the sphere. Thus, there must be a boundary layer of charge minus Q over 2 induced at R equals R1 so that the total enclosed charge in the Gauss surface is zero. For R larger than R2, there must be a boundary layer of charge plus 3 over 2q, so that the total charge of the sphere is still plus q. So, uses Gauss' law, this is the electric field. For part B, C and D, we need to integrate the E field with respect to R from R equals infinity, where V is zero, back to R. Remember, at infinity, electric potential is zero. So working from R equals infinity, for D, you find for R larger than R2, what Keith wrote here. Simple integration. He starts with D, by the way, not with B, C, D. He starts first with D. A reasonable thing to do. Now he does C. For R smaller than R2 and larger than R1, the potential must be the same as the potential at R equals R2, because E is zero within the conductor. So, he finds the potential. From setting R equals R2 in part D. But we know that R2 is 2R1, so he finds that the full potential is plus 3qk divided by 4 R1. So that's his answer to C. Now he does B. Considering just the center plus Q over 2 charge, I would expect the potential to be QK divided by 2R1 at R equals R1. But from part C, at R equals R1, the potential is QK divided by 4R1, higher. So I added that to the final expression for R smaller than R1 to get the value that you see here. So, he first does D, he then does C, and he then does B. We are planning that problem 218 will be a logical extension of this problem. I therefore urge you to study Keith's solution very closely. That will help you in doing problem 218.